Welcome to the teaching ministry of Reverend Daryl Baker, pastor of Christian Faith Fellowship. Pastor Baker is fulfilling the call of God on his life to preach the Word of God without compromise, raising up disciples who, through faith in God, will have a powerful impact on our world. May you be blessed through the message that Pastor Baker has to share with you today. May God's very best be yours.
Acts 19. Acts 19. I want you to go quickly tonight to Acts 19. I started on Sunday morning a message with you called God's Word, a Prevailing Force. God's Word, a Prevailing Force. When you go to dealing with or talking about the subject of faith, this is the most important truth that you can get a hold of as it relates to the subject of faith. Because as we saw Sunday, and of course I try the best I can to just at least kind of throw a few things out that we touched on so we can kind of hook up there and go on from there so people aren't walking blind into what we're talking about tonight. As we touched on Sunday morning, we showed over and over again, and we barely touched on a few verses about the most powerful prevailing force on the planet is the Word of God. Because the Word of God brought everything into existence. Everything that exists, exists because of the Word of God. There is nothing in existence in the universe, in this earth, or anything that we know of that did not come about by anything other than God's spoken Word. We know clearly Jesus himself declared of his ministry that he said only what the Father said. So I guarantee you can do a study on your own on this. When you look at the life and ministry of Jesus Christ, the miracles and the works that he did, most people have this premonition or thought about Jesus in his earthly ministry. They think that the way Jesus was able to do the things he did was because he was the Son of God. But that's not true in the sense that because he was God in flesh, that's why he did what he did. He did what he did because he knew the Father's word. And he had the anointing of God on his life. But you're no different. If you're born again, you have his word and you have the same Holy Spirit. He lived, yes, as God in flesh, but he lived as a man on this earth to show me and you how to live, to show me and you how to do stuff. So let me explain something. If you ever take the time to study the four Gospels, of everything Jesus ever did that was supernatural in origin, in touching another person's life, you will find out that almost roughly about 85 to 90% of anything he did supernaturally in a person's life came about by speaking the word of God and then believing it. Amen. And he shows this over and over again to us through scripture. Yes, we have the gifts of the Spirit. Yes, we can have those manifestation gifts in operation as the Spirit wills. But the honest truth is, even though Jesus functioned fully with all of those gifts on his life, we do not. That's why we need the whole body. But those gifts are manifested as the Spirit wills. Now listen, when a manifestation gift of the healing gifts, for example, manifests, you don't need no faith in the Word. All you got to do is have that person that's got that gift manifested. At the time it does, simply lay a hand upon you and the transfer of that anointing will deliver you from whatever sickness or disease you have. But that is not how we're supposed to live as believers. We're supposed to walk by faith and not by sight. And you're going to find out as I talk about tonight, hopefully that'll become more real to you than it ever has. Because this is a key to God's prevailing word. What you and I are supposed to recognize is there is no way you and I, following Christ's example, are going to overcome anything of ourselves. Amen. Jesus didn't overcome because of him. He even said it's the Father in me that does the work. How did he do that work? Two ways. His word, I say only what the Father says. And the anointing of God that was on his life. So honestly, he did not do what he did because he was the Son of God. He did what he did because he knew the Father. He knew the Father's words and he had the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Because again, he said, I don't do anything except what I see the Father doing. So you and I need to recognize that if you want to prevail in this life, what's the word prevail mean? Prove more powerful than any opposing force to be victorious. What is the most prevailing force on the planet? The Word of God. The Word of God, if recognized as a believer in the way that it's supposed to work in your life, like it did Jesus's, If you recognize how it's supposed to work in your life and then through your life, guess what? There's nothing more powerful than the Word of God. It is the prevailing force on the planet. Meaning what? If you learn how to put the Word of God at work in your life like Jesus did, and then through your life, guess what? It will prove itself more powerful than any opposing force, and it will be victorious. How you walk in victory is through the Word of God. It is the Word of God that prevails, not you. Amen. It's the Word that does. The Word is what prevails. You get to walk in the benefit of what the Word is here to do. Amen. When we walk in victory, it's because, yes, Jesus already purchased it for us and provided the ability for us to walk in it, but then He showed us how to do it. How? Through the Word of God. Over and over again, we showed examples of Jesus not even going and laying hands on people, but just speaking the Word. One of the two people Jesus recognized, as we saw Sunday, that He acknowledged had great faith was a centurion, a Roman soldier, who himself had no connection with God as a Jewish, as a part of the Jewish nation, because he wasn't a Jew. He was considered a Gentile. So in their day, obviously not even one who was in covenant with God, because only the Jews were under the Old Testament. But yet he believed in the power of the words Jesus spoke, and he certainly had to believe and know those words came from the Father, because he recognized, like you under authority, I too am a man under authority. And I know these words aren't yours. They come from God. Because I'm paraphrasing, because that's what he's telling him. Because like me as a Roman soldier, if I tell this regiment of mine, you go and do this, guess what? They go and do it. The Word prevails. Amen. They're not doing it because I'm standing there. They're doing it because of what I said. They're doing it because of what I declared. And the Word I declare has authority with it because I'm under authority. And I understand, Jesus, you're under authority. And all you got to do is speak the Word. When he came to him and said, my servant lies at home paralyzed. What did Jesus immediately say? Oh, I'll come and heal him. Right. Now, who wouldn't have said, okay, yeah, come on, man, let's go. Exactly. But he didn't, because he was a Gentile. He said, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. That's how he felt. Now, Jesus would have gone anyway, but he said, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. But notice what he said, but just speak the Word. See, even this Roman soldier, all the Jewish nation didn't get what this Roman soldier got, that most Christians today still don't understand. Amen. It was the Word that did the work. Amen. He knew, just speak the Word and my servant will be healed. And Jesus marveled. Amen. Could you imagine the expression on his face when he heard that from that centurion servant? Well, I'll come and heal him. No, you don't have to come. Right?
Yeah.
If you're sitting here at church today, say you had somebody at home sick, you're wanting God to go heal him. Jesus comes to you in church and says, hey, I'll go home with you and heal him. I'll go home with you and heal him. You'd say, okay, come on, let's go. But the centurion didn't do that. And he had great faith. How many want to get in the level of great faith? You know why he had great faith? Because he knew it's the Word that does it. It's the power of the Word that created everything. He didn't probably know it created everything. Maybe he did, because the first five books of the Pentateuch, including Genesis, were around. And I'm sure you've probably heard somebody talk about them a little bit, knowing God created all things through the Word. God said, God said, God said. But he understood, just speak the Word. What did Jesus do? Marveled. I had found such great faith amongst all the Jewish nation. He said, all right, as you believe, so be it unto you. And when he finally got home, he inquired, and when that servant got delivered and got healed, the same hour. Same hour Jesus spoke. Right. Can I get any amens tonight? Amen. So what did he know about great faith? I'll tell you what, it's not you, child of God. It's not your wisdom. It's not all your knowledge of the Bible and you being smarter than any other Christian that's going to get you in a position to prevail. Guess what? It's the Word. Because it's not you that's going to prevail. It's the Word that prevails. You of yourself, even as a believer, don't have the power in the context of who you are as an individual. The Word is what's anointed. Now, sure, the anointing's on your life. The Holy Spirit's in your life. And yes, God can do things with the anointing of God as well. But the primary way we're supposed to live, thus saith the New Testament, we're to walk by the anointing of God.
Faith.
Nope. We're to walk by faith, not by sight. Now, I want you to write this down because I want to show you something. Walking by faith is choosing not to live by your five senses, when it comes to the Word of God. I'm going to say that again. Walking by faith is choosing to live not by your five physical senses when it comes to the Word of God. That's walking by faith. Walking by faith is not based on your five senses. It's based on the Word of God. So you go contrary to your five physical senses. You don't do what you do. You don't believe what you believe. You don't say what you say based on your five physical senses when you walk by faith. When you walk by faith, you do what you do. You say what you say and you believe what you believe based on this Word, not what you see in the natural. Amen. You don't go by the Thomas kind of faith. Amen. Well, I could believe if I could see the hole. Holes in his hands, the hole in his side. All the rest of them believed because they were initially told by the, well, they honestly didn't to a degree. Some did. But the point I'm making is to walk by faith to overcome means I believe the Word. And if I believe the Word, you know what that means? Then I don't respond based on my five physical senses. I respond based on that Word. Amen. Because it's the Word that prevails. Amen. It's the Word that prevails. Amen. So Jesus clearly again said, I say nothing except what I hear the Father say. What happens when you speak the Word? What's the Word going to do? It's the prevailing force in the planet. What's it going to do? Prove itself, not you. The Word's going to prove itself more powerful than any opposing force on the planet and be victorious. And guess what? You get to walk in the victory. Because it's not you that did it. A lot of Christians, well, I'm trying to get healed. Well, I'm trying to get blessed. And you're going to keep on trying because it ain't you that's going to get healed. It ain't you that's going to get blessed. It's the Word that's going to heal your body. Amen. It's the Word that's going to cause you to walk in the benefit of what God has for you. Amen. It's the Word that prevails. Amen. Jesus knew this. And you see all through his earthly ministry, the Word, the Word, the Word, the Word. Jesus spoke to a fig tree. Right. What destroyed that fig tree? Not the anointing. The Word did. Right. Jesus spoke to a storm. Yes. We saw it Sunday. Yes. The laws of nature submitted to the Word of God. The Word of God prevailed over the laws of nature. The Word of God prevailed over natural creation. The Word of God prevailed over a paralyzed body. The Word of God prevailed over demons. He cast them out with the Word. The Word of God healed almost everybody in his earthly ministry because the Bible says so. Amen. He cast out demons with the Word and healed many who were sick. With what? A word. Jesus, in a time of visitation where Brother Hagin told him, he said, you go even look in my own hometown. And all through my ministry, anybody that believed what I said, because what's coming out of his mouth? The Father's words. Yes. Anybody believed what I said, receive whatever I said. Yes. But if they didn't believe it, they didn't receive it. You want to know why I couldn't do many mighty miracles in my own hometown? They did not believe what I said. And the words he spoke were not his. Right. They were the Father's, which is the what? The thing that created everything. Right. Isn't that right? Yeah. So he said, everywhere I went, everywhere Jesus went, the Bible says he went about doing miracles, signs, and wonders. No, it does not. The Bible says he went about teaching. Yes. Preaching, number two. Healing, number three. Right. And all through the Bible it says many came to him to hear and be healed. What prevailed? The Word did. Yes. So every time the Word was believed, the Word was prevailing. Yes. Amen. If the Word is truly Biblically believed, it will prevail. Yes. But there is one thing we saw Sunday more. I don't want to say more powerful. There is one thing that will stop the power of God from working, the power of God's Word from working in a person's life. And that's your own religious or own human traditions. Let's say you've been conditioned in your mind to believe God doesn't heal everybody. However that belief came about. Let's say you were conditioned to believe that. Well, God doesn't heal everybody. And if that's your belief system, if that's what your mind truly believes, we can sit here and tell you the Bible all day long of what Scripture says about healing, and it's already provided. It's for everybody. But guess what? As long as you believe he doesn't heal everybody, that word, the Bible says, will have no effect upon you because of your tradition. Yep. Because of what you believe. That's why you got to guard against who you listen to. Amen. That's why at one time, years ago, we even had some teachings that were being brought into the church for different meetings. And then we found out this person doesn't believe that God heals all the time. And it came out in those teachings. And we immediately ditched those teachings. You know why? I don't want anybody hearing that in my church. Right. Because if you start getting that thought in your brain, well, God doesn't heal everybody. Wrong. Not everybody receives healing.
Right.
Healing's available to everybody. Either by his stripes you were healed, or it's by his stripes only certain were.
No.
But it never says certain ones.
No.
Never, ever, never.
No.
Right? Right? So that's what I'm telling you. You could have the mindset, I'm going to be poor. I've always been poor. I've never amounted to anything. This is why, like we talked to the mothers last night, you got to watch what you say to your kids. Because if you're diminishing and running them down, guess what you're doing? You're creating a false belief system that can cause the Word of God to have no effect on their life as they grow up.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
So what we got to do is we got to deal with what? Our minds. We got to deal with this mind. Because the whole key of the Word prevailing through you is the Word must prevail in you.
Amen.
If the Word does not prevail over your thinking, it will not prevail through you. If your thinking doesn't get corrected, if your mind doesn't get fully renewed, then guess what? The Word can't prevail to you. Your tradition will make the Word of God of no effect. Let's look at another verse that refers to the power of the prevailing Word of God. What's the word prevail mean? Everybody tell me out loud together. Go.
To prove more powerful than any opposing force. To be victorious.
That was horrible. Everybody, one time. Come on, do it. Go. Say that's the word. Because there is no more powerful prevailing force in the entire, not just on the earth, in all of the universe that we know, because it created everything. All right, Acts chapter 19. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Verse 20. Now this is referring to a time in which Paul had been preaching at Ephesus. He had seen miracles there as he was preaching the word, preaching the word. And to the degree that even, yes, there were supernatural things happening with handkerchiefs being brought to him. But I want you to see as he gets down here then to verse 20, what it says about the word. So the word of the Lord grew mightily, and it did what?
Prevail.
What did it do?
Prevail.
It prevailed. Why did it prevail? Because it grew mightily. The word has to grow. It has to grow on your thinking. It has to grow on your way of seeing things. It has to grow by being taught. I showed you Sunday that God, as the Bible clearly states, and they are specific in order in 1 Corinthians 12, set things in the church that the church needed. What was the first one? Apostles, because the forerunners have to go into areas where the gospel hasn't been preached or there's never going to be a church. What's the second gift?
Prophets.
In this order. Why is the prophetic gift important in the church? Because if you don't have a prophetic word of who the pastor's supposed to be by God, you could wind up with some in the pulpit that's not anointed to be that pastor.
Right?
Right? What's the third gift?
Teacher.
In order. What's the third?
Teacher.
After that, after teacher, this is the gifts of the Father, not Jesus. After that, working of miracles, then gifts of healings. But those are below the teaching gift. These are set in order in the church by the Father, right? Then helps, administrations. But guess what? Teaching comes before even miracles and healings in God's eyes. Why? Because the Word is what prevails.
Amen.
It's the Word that's preached and signs follow. Can I get a better amen?
Amen.
So here clearly it says that the Lord did what? The Word of the Lord did what? It grew mightily. How did the Word grow mightily? Because it was being taught. And it was being preached, and people were hearing it, and they were getting their minds renewed, and they were receiving it. How do we know? Because it began to prevail.
Amen.
Where the word's not received, it cannot prevail.
Right.
So obviously it was.
Yes.
Here in this case in Ephesus, in the areas where Paul was preaching. Go to John 15.
Right.
I just wanted to show you another verse that the Bible reveals about how the word can prevail as it grows. Say it must grow. All right, John 15. Come on, go quickly now, real quick, to a couple verses with me. Oh, I want to get in this tonight. John 15, verse 5. We're going to go back to verse 5. John 15, verse 5. So if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
All right, watch this. Jesus said, I'm the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears what?
Much fruit.
Much fruit. For without me, you can do what? Jesus is also the Word who was made manifest and dwelt among men.
Right.
Correct?
Correct?
So he said, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Tell somebody, you're not the vine, you're the branch.
You're not the vine.
So you're supposed to be the one bearing fruit.
Amen.
You're supposed to want, be the one seeing the things that God wants working in your life, coming into manifestation, come to fruition. Watch this. He said, he who abides in me. How do you abide in Jesus? Got to get born again. Got to get born again. The simple truth here of abiding in Jesus is you must get born again. But he said, I must also what? Abide in you. That's the word getting alive in you. That's you becoming one with the word. You abide in him. You, in other words, come alive in him. How do you come alive in Jesus? You receive him as your Savior, because the word abide means to be one. So you, how do you become one with Jesus? You become one with Jesus when you get born again. But guess what? But Jesus needs to do what? Become one with you. The word, as he's about to tell you in verse 7, must become one with you. Verse 6, if anyone does not abide in me, that's born again. That's not being obedient to all the word. That's born again. Notice the phrase. This is why he defines it. If anyone does, because people are saying, well, how do you know abiding in Jesus doesn't mean abiding in the word? He's about to tell you. Verse 6, if anyone does not abide in me, he's cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire and they're burned. Anybody know any idea where that's at? So that means if you're not born again, guess what? You're going eventually to the lake of fire. So he's defining in verse 6 what he's telling you in verse 5 and about to tell you again in verse 7, abiding in him is. Abiding in him is being born again. So if you're abiding in Jesus, if anybody here is one with Jesus, born again, raise your hand if that's you.
Yes.
So you got that down. You're abiding in him. Yes. Verse 7, now notice if. So now he's going to give us a promise with this. But it's based on some conditions. If you abide in me. So again, he just told you how to do that, because that refers to being born again. Because if you're born again, you're not going to go to this lake of fire.
Right.
So if you abide in me, and here's the key. Here's what we got to learn to do. And my words abide in you. I want you to get this. Let me read the rest of the verse. And if my words abide in you, you will ask. You will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. You want to know why? Because when the word abides in you, the word abide there means the word becomes one with you. If the word becomes one with you, guess what's going to come out of your mouth? The word of God. What does the word of God do? It prevails over any opposing force. And that's why when the word starts getting one with you, now when you ask what you desire, it shall be done. You want to know why? Because God watches over his word to perform it.
Yes, he does.
Amen.
Yes,
he
does. Amen.
The problem with the believer is the word is not one with them. The word is not one with them. If you are not walking in the prevailing victory you have as a child of God, I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to answer your question. Why? Because the word's not one with you. Now, let me help you with something. A lot of Christians think renewal of the mind and the word being one with me is me just getting my mind to believe what all the Bible says. But renewal of the mind is far more than just filling your head with the knowledge of the word. There are many Christians who have knowledge of the Bible, but I'm going to show you tonight, their minds are not renewed. You could quote the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and still not have your mind renewed to the Word of God.
Right.
Because if your mind's been renewed, what are you now? You're one with the Word.
Right.
What's that going to look like?
Jesus.
What's that going to look like? What are your actions going to look like? I want you to get this point tonight. Most people in the body of Christ think the renewal of the mind is just getting this thing up here to know everything that that book says. No, it's not. You do need to get this mind knowledgeable what's in that book so that you can continue to do what's necessary to now walk out what is the renewal of the mind. I'm going to tell you again, because we just found out, John 15:7. The word's what prevails. The whole point of this entire message that I'm teaching you is it's the word that prevails. There's nothing that the word cannot change.
Amen.
Say it. There's nothing that the word cannot change. I don't care what your situation is. I don't care what your family life is like. I don't care what your kids' situation is. I don't care what your health situation is like. I don't care what your finances is like. I got a word for you. There is a prevailing force on the planet, and it prevails over everything because it created everything.
Amen.
The only thing that stops it is the will of a human that won't let that word become one with them. You can be born again. You can know the Bible. Many Christians do. And the word is still not one with them. I want you to get, this is my key point tonight. This is the Holy Spirit's key point tonight. For the word to abide in you, the word has to become one with you. When the word becomes one with you, like Jesus had the word one with him, I got a word for you. You won't have ever a question about faith again. Faith will be a non-issue to you because you will be walking by faith and not by sight. You will never walk by faith by walking in line with the five physical senses and trying to walk in line with the Word of God. They don't mix because you're not one with the Word. I gave you the example Sunday. The Bible's very clear. The Bible has set up for me and you a way to prosper. The Bible, I mean, it's so simple. Seed time and harvest. Long as the earth remains, plant a seed, harvest comes. But until somebody becomes one with that word in their life, their mind fully renewed, guess what? It'll never work for them. And you're not going to become one with that word until you start doing what the word says. That is my key phrase for tonight. You're not one with the word if you're not doing it.
Come on, that's good.
You're not one with the word if you're not doing it. You can believe in tithing. You can agree with tithing. You can agree with offerings. You can believe what the Bible says about offerings. But your mind is not renewed and you're not one with the word until you start doing what the Bible says to do with your money. You can believe God for a blessed marriage. You can pray to God for a blessed marriage. You can ask God to bless your marriage. I'm not saying that's wrong, but you're never going to have a blessed marriage until you start doing what the Bible says you're supposed to do in the marriage.
That's right.
Yeah, but they're not doing their part. Oh, you're working out their salvation also? Well, I tried that. Well, there's your problem. You chose not to be one with the word. You chose to try the word. That's different. When you choose to be one with the word, this is my lifestyle, come hell or high water, in Jesus' name, excuse the phrase, but you know, people, I don't care what happens. I'm doing what this Bible says. And I'm going to show you tonight, the average believer is not walking in meekness when it comes to the word. And that's why they're not one with the word. Not because they don't mean to, but I promise you what, they've been so conditioned to live by their feelings. By their flesh. Yeah, but they hurt me. Yeah, but you didn't hear what they say. Yeah, but you don't know the pain my body's in. I don't have to. I know something that can change it. It's called the prevailing word of God. But until you become one with the word, it won't prevail through you. You got to become one with the word. Jesus said it. If you abide in me, you're one with me. And I and my word abides. My word and I are one with you. So until the word becomes one with you, guess what? It doesn't prevail through you. God's word. I want you to write this down. Real simple phrase. God's word is living in us. God's word is living in us to the measure we live them. I want you to listen to that phrase. I want you to think about it. God's word is living in us to the measure we live them. Not in them, to the measure we live them. Say it, God's word.
God's word.
Say it this way, personalize it. God's word, is living in me to the measure I live the word. That determines how much of the word is living in you. What determines how much the word is living in me? What determines how much I'm one with the word? How much you live it. The less you live the word, the less you're one with the word. If you're one with the word, you're going to look like the word.
Yes.
This isn't rocket science. This is so easy and people miss it. And it's so simple. So simple. You know, a chameleon. Anybody seen a chameleon?
Yep.
A chameleon obviously has to physically change to look like whatever it is actually on at the time, which they have the ability to do so, to change their color for a form of protection, right? But if they don't do something physically in the way of change, they're not going to look like what it is that they're on at the time. If they're on a stick of wood and they're still green in color and they don't change, if there's no physical actual change, they're not one with the wood.
Right.
And a bird's probably going to see them in their history. Amen?
Amen?
But see, a lot of Christians still look like the world, and that's why the enemy's so attracted to you. Ooh, you're preaching pretty good now, Pastor. Because if you look like the world, which he is the God of, he's pretty attracted to that stuff. And guess what else gets attracted to you? Worldly people and worldly stuff. But if I'm one with the Word and I'm living in line with the Word, guess what that attracts? That attracts God's stuff.
Yes.
That attracts the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. The anointing. Come on, church.
Amen.
So we have to do what? Become one with the Word to prevail. And again, I'm going to say it one more time. God's Word is living in us to the measure we live them. To the measure you live the Word, that is to the degree that you're living, that God's Word is living in you. God's Word's not living in you. It's not one with you unless you're living according to the Word of God. To the degree you live according to the Word, that become one with you.
Amen.
Go to James chapter 1.
Amen.
James chapter 1. Are you getting anything tonight?
Yes.
Oh, hang on, man. Tell your neighbor, I hope you get ready to shift her in fourth gear because we're about to hit another gear right here, man. Praise the Lord. You better have your seatbelt on. Got your spiritual seatbelt on? Tell somebody behind you, you better have their spiritual seatbelt on. I'm telling you right now. Praise the Lord. Because if you don't, man, we could have a runner in the room tonight. Now, if you're not Pentecostal and didn't grow up in Pentecostal church, what's a runner? Like my stocking or something, you know? Or what? No, I mean, somebody gets so excited by the Word, man, they can't help it. They jump up and take off running because they get so excited. That's called revelation knowledge. I said, that's called revelation knowledge.
Amen.
I want you to write this down for me. Write this down. There, before you write anything down, let me say something real quick. And I'm going to have you write this down. The average Christian has what's known as human knowledge of the Word or sense knowledge of the Word. That's just reading the Bible and filling my brain with what it says. But that's not what actually causes the Word to prevail in us. We need revelation knowledge of the Word. Write this down. Revelation knowledge comes to us through the recreated human spirit by acting on the Word and living in it. I'll say it several times. Revelation knowledge comes to us. How does it come, Pastor? I'm going to prove it to you through the book of James. Revelation knowledge comes to us through the recreated human spirit. It comes up out of your recreated human spirit. Revelation knowledge. See, that's not coming from your head. By acting on the Word and living in it. Say it again. Revelation knowledge comes to us through the recreated human spirit by acting on the Word and living in it. Thus saith the book of James. I encourage you tonight before I send you home. I'll tell you what you can do between now and next Sunday night. Study, meditate, read, and glean everything you can out of James chapter 1 and James chapter 2. Because you understand when they wrote these letters, they weren't writing down one little subject here and in a few verses another. They're writing about a topic that would lead into some other things, but then they would tend to pick back up on the topic they started with. And then they would go back into some other. Then they would pick back up again. This happens all through the Bible. So what James starts with here, he's not just finishing the topic of conversation. He continues on with it as he goes through the book of James, chapter 1, chapter 2. Chapter 3, he ties right to that with the importance of your mouth and your words.
Amen.
But James 1 and 2 is all about your actions, how you live, what you do. Watch this. Are you ready?
Yes.
That's three of you. The rest of you catch up real quick. James 1, 6. James 1, 6. Now, we understand for the sake of time, he's talking about, well, let's read it. Verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into what? See, that would have to do everything with what's going on in the natural.
Right.
But if you're walking by faith, you can count it joy because that doesn't move you.
Amen.
Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. Testing of your faith means I believe the Word, therefore I act upon it. I've taught you this so many times. Hebrews 11 is believing what the Bible says and I do it. Well, guess what? Stuff in the natural is going to test you on that. Trials, just in this fallen world, stuff's going to test you on that. It's going to try to get you to not do what the Bible says. Verse 4, but let patience, that's being consistent at doing the Bible. What's faith? Doing what God said. Say it. I'm going to do what God said. Say it. I'm going to do. That's faith, because you believe what he said is true. You do it. Let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking what? Wouldn't that sound like prevailing to you? Yes, it would. And that would be the word prevailing through you. And that's what he's about to tell you. He goes on to say in verse 5, now, if any of you lack wisdom, if you lack any understanding at all about things in this life, do what? Ask of God. Go to God. Ask God, who gives to all what? Liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Verse 6, but let him ask in what?
Faith.
Watch this. Asking God. Oh, man. How do you ask for God? How do you ask God for wisdom and faith? Here's how. All right, God, I'm having problems in this area of my life. I've looked to the Word. I can't seem to find a resolve. Please give me wisdom. What do I need to do here? Now, listen, asking for that in faith means when God tells me, I'm going to do whatever he says. No matter how crazy it sounds, as long as it's not opposed to the Word, whatever he tells me, that's what I'm going to do. Because if you're not going to do what he tells you, you didn't ask in faith. Because faith does what God says. So when you ask for wisdom in faith, God's saying, I'm not going to give you wisdom if you don't ask in faith. God knows the heart of every man. If I know what I tell you you're not going to do, why would I tell you? Why would I tell you what the problem is if you're not going to do it? But if you need wisdom about something, and here's the difference. You want wisdom simply because you don't really want to change. I have a word for you. If you're not prevailing, guess what you're not doing? You are not walking in the light of the Word in some area of your life. Because if you become one with that Word will prevail through you. That was a mouthful. If you're not prevailing, you're not walking one with the Word. If I'm not walking one with the Word, what does that mean, Pastor? You're going to have to change something you're doing.
Amen.
Not just thinking, but what you're doing. Because if you don't change what you're doing, you're not walking one with the Word. The Word's not going to prevail through you. So if I'm lacking understanding of why I'm not seeing results in the area of my life, why am I going to go to God and ask him and not apply whatever I know he tells me? Then what'd you ask him for? Right? Asking for wisdom and faith means what, Pastor? It means you're going to do whatever God tells you to do. Because faith does what? It does what God says.
Yes.
So if I ask for wisdom, I'm going to do what God said.
Yes.
I started talking to God about my marriage when things weren't good. God, you got to show me what's wrong. And you know what he did? I thought he was going to tell me all the stuff that he had to deal with her on yet. You know, and all the stuff he was going, you know what he did? He started showing me all the stupid stuff I was doing.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Well, let me tell you why she's doing that, son, because you're doing this. Yeah, but she's doing that. I don't care. You're doing that. But see, thankfully, thank God he knew I asked in faith because I really did want my marriage to change. And I told Kathy and I told God, I'll do whatever it takes. And he knew my heart. And thank God he showed me. Thank God he began to tell me. I wouldn't have received that wisdom if he'd have known I wouldn't have done it. If he knew I was asking for wisdom to fix my marriage, but it was only for me not to change, but to change her, I'd have never got that. And my marriage would have never changed. Thank you for all your amens tonight.
Amen.
So James chapter 1 again, verse 6. If you're going to ask for wisdom, you got to ask in faith. That means you're going to do what he tells you.
Anything.
With no what?
Doubting.
With no what?
Doubting.
So doubting is in the mind, but it's related to what you do.
Amen.
The mind's not renewed until you start living the Bible. The mind's not renewed just because you know in your head what the Bible says. It's not fully renewed until you start living it. You're not one with it till you start living it. I'm going to tell you something. Oh, man, I hope you grab this point tonight. I'm about to point it out to you. When you start doing what the Bible says,
yes,
your mind gets renewed to believe what it says.
Right. Amen. Still.
You start doing what it says, your mind will start getting in line and believing what it says.
Right. Good. Yeah, that's good word.
Because he just said, if you ask, you got to ask in what? Faith. You're going to see it in a minute because he's going to bring it up in the next chapter. Faith without corresponding action is. So why would you ask if you're not going to correspond? Why would you ask if you're not going to act upon what he tells you? So ask in faith with what? No doubting. So if I'm doubting, guess what? I'm not willing to live what he said. Because I'm not willing to live what he said, my brain's going to doubt it. Do you see the correlation? You're going to watch this all through James 1 and 2. Ask in faith, no doubting. For he who doubts is like what? He's like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. Look at me. What is he referring to now? Natural senses.
Right.
Natural senses. He who doubts is going to be conditioned, led by, walk out what the natural senses tell him to do. Can you see that? Verse 7, let not that man or woman, just talking about humans, let not that man suppose that he will receive what?
Anything.
What? Let that man not receive, suppose he'll receive anything from the Lord. Why? Verse 8, because he is a what? A double-minded man, unstable in all his what? Unstable in all his what? All his what? What he does. He's unstable in what he does. So what he just told you is that a person who is double-minded is somebody who can even know what the word says. If you know what the word says, but you don't do it, you're double-minded. I hope you get that. If you don't get it tonight, go listen to this message tomorrow and regurgitate on that about 15, 20 times each day. I mean, in your thinking, and let get a hold of it. Sorry for the word, but maybe that'll grab your attention a little bit. I mean, just over and over and over again, get a hold of that truth. Can you say amen?
Yes.
What's a double-minded man? One who knows in their brain what the Bible says, but they don't do what the Bible says. That's a double-minded man. Because you're going to doubt. If you don't do this Bible, you're going to doubt it. Can you say amen? This is why I've said for years, if you're a Christian and you can't live the basics of Christianity, but yet you want to walk by faith, you're not even going to get there.
Right.
Because if you can't walk out the basics of Christianity, obviously you don't believe what God says is true. Because if you believe what God said was true and you believed it was for your benefit, then why wouldn't you walk out the basics of Christianity? Why would you do that? If God says it's good for you to go to the house of God and it's good for you not to forsake it, because obviously you're going to get to be able to talk the word of God, get in my presence and fellowship with others, but you're not going to do that. You can't even be consistent at doing that, but you want to overcome cancer when it comes. You want to overcome disease and sickness and all these things when it comes. Where your treasure is, there your heart is also. You can't give. You can't give to the kingdom of God. It's no wonder we have so few of people of faith in the body of Christ, because only 3% actually give their tithe.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You can't trust him with your money.
Are you here tonight?
Yes.
If you can't even give money, you're honoring God with your money. You can't do, and the Bible tells you this. Mm-hmm. I know all the hand tithings. Oh, give me a break, man. All right. So even if you don't want to believe tithing, would you believe the words of Jesus?
Yes.
Give and it shall be.
Yes.
Wow, I want it given unto me. What do you got to do? Give, yes, darling. Give. Mm-hmm. Corinthians. So sparingly.
Sparingly.
So bountifully.
Bountifully.
So even if you don't want to recognize the tithe, which, by the way, bountifully would certainly be more than the tithe.
Right.
Recognize those verses. Well, believe you have to give. Your tradition,
yes,
makes the word of God no effect. Meaning what? You won't do it. If you don't do, you can't trust God with what he calls unrighteous mammon. And you think you're going to be a faith giant? You think you're going to believe what you speak of the word of God will come to pass in other areas of your life when you can't do the basic? I didn't say you were doing that. Smile. I'm not looking at you like you're not doing that. I'm talking hypothetically. A Christian who doesn't even do the basics of Christianity. I've watched it my whole life as 27 years as a pastor. I've watched Christians who live this Bible, and they are the ones who I see the word of God prevailing in and through their life. Consistently. I've watched others who will not do what this Bible says. They will not forgive. They will not walk in love. They will not give to the kingdom consistently. Now, I don't mean like all of them. I'm just saying they don't do these things. They don't do some of these things. They forsake assembling. You harp on church attendance. I ain't harping on it. I'm trying to help you walk by faith. You can't do what the Bible says, and yet you want to walk by faith. Ain't going to happen, darling. Sorry, it ain't going to happen because the Bible said so. Not because your pastor, not because I said so.
Right.
Obey those who have the rule over you and be submissive because they watch out for your soul. I ain't doing that, bless God. Well, then you ain't going to walk by faith.
Preaching good.
Because these are simple truths in the Bible. Now you learn what they mean, but they're simple truths. And if the Word's one with you, guess what you're doing? You're doing the Word. The Word's not one with you until you do the Word.
Amen.
And I'm serious. I guarantee you, I've watched it all these years. People consistent in church, I watch them. I watch them rise up. I watch them begin to walk in the things of God for their life. I watch them begin to overcome. I watch, because you know what? Not just because they should. Now, you can show up all day long, get head knowledge, but if you don't ever go apply what you're being taught. So again, just coming to church ain't the deal. You're coming here to learn to go do what the Bible says.
Amen.
You're being equipped to go do the work of ministry. Right? All right. James 1 again. So he says in verse 8, this is a double-minded man who is somebody who what? Doubts. Why would doubt arise in your head? Because you are not renewed in your mind yet. If your mind was renewed and one with the Word, would you doubt?
No.
I said it again. I'm going to say it again. If your mind was renewed, one with the Word, would you doubt? But again, we think renewal is just all about getting a bunch of head knowledge. The Bible says knowledge by itself puffs up. What do you mean knowledge by itself? Not act it out. If you don't live it out, you're going to get all puffed up. You're going to really think you're somebody really religious and holier than everybody else. But I guarantee you the Pharisees did that.
Amen?
They were the most puffy people on the planet in Jesus' day. Puffed up with all kinds of pride. And they knew the scriptures better than anybody. But you know what? They weren't doing them. They weren't doing it. All right, move on. Come on. James 1, 21. Drop down to verse 21. Same chapters, just for the sake of time. Because again, we can't go through every verse. Therefore, let's throw in verse 19 and 20. So then, my beloved brethren, what? Now notice there's something you're supposed to do here. Beloved brethren, believers, let every man be what?
Swift-hearing.
What if you're not? You're not a doer of the Word.
Right.
If you're not doing the Word, guess what? You're not renewing your mind.
Right.
Be swift to hear, be slow to
speak.
What if you're not slow to speak? What if y'all just spouting your mouth off? Open wide your lips and you'll have destruction, the Bible says. Slow to wrath. Why? Because the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. What are we talking about? May you not lose the whole focus of what we're talking about, because James hasn't drifted from this subject either, by the way. We're talking about the prevailing Word of God. But for the Word to prevail through you, it has to prevail over you. Over your thinking, over your life, you have to become one with the Word. Your mind's not renewed till you start living the Word. How do we know? Look on, verse 21. Here we go. Therefore, lay aside. Notice the phrase. Notice the very first thing he says. Lay aside. Say, I got to do this. Lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness. Step one. Then do what? Receive with meekness. Receive with meekness the implanted Word, which is able to save your souls. So you're not renewing your mind until you're doing what the Bible says. He's about to tell you directly, but he just told you in that verse. Because if you're laying aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, guess what? You're not walking in line with the Word. You walked in that before you knew Jesus. You walked in that before you were born again. Well, I didn't walk in filthiness. Every one of us did, because there's nothing good in the flesh. Let me read it from another translation. This is powerful. Get rid of all immoral behavior. All immoral behavior. Is gossip moral behavior? Is it immoral behavior? Yet how many Christians gossip? God says he hates certain things in the Old Testament and still does in the New. What he hated in the Old, he still hates in the New. Not people, but you know what he hates? He hates a slanderous mouth. Because it don't do anybody any good. Isn't that right? Are we supposed to be speaking slanderously about other people? If you are you walking in faith? Is your mind renewed? Are you going to be double-minded?
Yes.
Yep. Are you going to doubt other parts of the word? Yes, you will. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So it says here in this other translation, get rid of all immoral behavior and the wicked things you do. Humbly accept the word of God. That's the key. Humbly accept the word of God that God has placed in you. The word can save you. The word, that's the last part of the phrase, which is able. What's able? The word is. Verse 21, receive with meekness the implanted what? Word. And the word which is implying the word. The word is able to do what? It's able to save you. Say it. The word's able to save me. In this text, save your soul, the mind, will, and emotions. You know why? Because I'll tell you why. If you start walking out the word and renew your mind to the word, guess what? You're going to start seeing the word prevail.
Amen.
Save there is what? Sozo. Healed, delivered, preserved, made whole. What does that? He just told you what does that. What does that? The word does that. But here's a key. You're not going to live out the word unless you receive the word with meekness. Humility. Receive the implanted word with what? Meekness. He just said the word doesn't get implanted unless you receive it with meekness. What do you mean receive it with meekness, with humility? We're back to what he said in James 1 about doubting and about asking in faith. Why would you ask of God something you wouldn't do? So in context to receiving the word with meekness, here's what it means. Whatever that Bible says as it relates to me, a New Testament Christian, I'm going to do it. I don't care what my brain says. I don't care what my body says. I don't care what my wife says. I don't care what my husband says. I don't care what my kids say. I don't care what my parents say. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what the president says. I don't care what the government says. I don't care what the devil says. If the Bible said this is what I'm to do as a child of God, I'm going to do whatever the Bible says. That's becoming one with the word. But receiving meekness means I am so humble that I'm humble enough to know he's smarter than me. Because he's smarter than me, old prideful one, not you. An old prideful one would be, well, all right, what does the Bible say about that? Here's what you hear. I know the Bible says that. Okay, old prideful one, you don't receive the Bible with meekness. Like I was talking to somebody earlier on the phone, and said, the thing is, there's a difference between ignorance, not knowing what the Bible says, and what we actually know as stupidity or idolatry. Well, I know that the Bible said I should give, but I don't think God's going to make a big deal out of that with me. I don't think he really means that I have to. Now, I know the Bible says it, but no, you just actually made an idol out of your own life, a God to fit you. I have to give. No, you get to.
Yes.
You get to because you don't serve money. You serve God.
Yes.
Can you say amen?
Yes.
But see, as people look to the Bible, you can tell when somebody receives it with meekness, even in context to counseling or anything. You know why? Because the ones that receive it with meekness, I have a word for you. Your flesh doesn't want to do what the Bible says. Have you figured that one out yet? It doesn't want to do what the Bible says. The Bible says if you want to overcome like Jesus did, you will have to suffer like he did.
Yes.
I'll say it again. The Bible says if you want to overcome like Jesus did, you're going to have to suffer like he did.
Yes.
Thus saith the word of God. What do you mean suffer? Guess what? He didn't do everything his flesh wanted to do.
Right.
He did only what the Father wanted to do. Do you really believe that Jesus in 33 and a half years of walking in all of Israel in his life did not see Roman crucifixions take place? How many saw the Passion? Or risen recently? I'm going to tell you what. Everything we know from actual scholars of the day said everything that's ever been out on a movie still does not compare to what you see of a Roman scourging. Now, if you saw that happen... Remember, I know he's the Son of God, but he's living as a man, tempted in everything as we are, but he never violated what God said to do. Do you really think he's not thinking about that? Do you really not think he's not thinking about what that's going to be like? The pain that's... You don't think he didn't feel the pain? How many of you would like to volunteer tonight to come up here? We'll go get a big old spike and we'll drive it through your wrist. Anybody want to do that? Now, if you just start thinking about that, doesn't that start actually thinking about actually being a little painful?
Yes.
Not a lot of fun? Right? And how many people would say, well, man, I'm going to make sure that don't happen to me. But Jesus, guess what? Had to think about it knowing I'm doing what the Father said to do.
Amen.
And I guarantee you, his flesh didn't want to do it. Your flesh does not want to forgive your spouse when they wrong you. Your flesh doesn't want to forgive your boss when they wrong you. Your flesh doesn't want to go talk to a person that God's nudging you to go talk to because your flesh is afraid what they will think of you.
Amen.
Your flesh, if led by it, does not want to give. It wants to take everything it can get. Bodily exercise profits a little. Your flesh don't like that.
No, not at all.
It does profit. Thus saith the New Testament.
Yes.
Godliness profits in every realm. But guess what? Jesus exercised a lot. You know why? They walked everywhere they went.
Yeah.
You can't just throw out exercise. I'm just going to hang on the couch the rest of my life. Yeah, and you're probably not going to live a real healthy life because bodily exercise does profit. Thank you for all the amens about this. See, if you got to become one with the Word. You got to do what you got to live the Bible. But guess what happens when you start becoming one with it by living it? You stop doubting all of what Scripture says. All of a sudden, doubt goes by the wayside. And when now it comes to other realms, other areas of the Bible to believe in a promise, guess what? You don't believe it's a promise anymore. You know it's an actual reality. You already know it's true.
Amen.
You have no problem doubting it. What hinders people from doubting the Bible? I'll tell you what does. They're not one with the Word. What causes them not to be one with the Word? They're not doing what the Word says.
Right.
Read on, darling. Because here's what it tells you about you and I renewing our minds to the Word. Lay aside all filthiness, overflow wickedness. Receive with meekness, total humility. What's that mean? I'm going to do whatever it says.
Yes.
Say it. I'm going to do whatever it says.
Yes.
Now, I guarantee you, your flesh won't want to a lot of times. Right? Does the Bible tell us to wash our mind with the water of the Word?
Yes.
How often do you think you ought to do that?
Every day.
Then the Bible revealed that obviously even in the context of the Old Testament talks about renewing our minds to the Word as well as the New Testament. But your flesh don't like that. Right? It'd rather sit in entertainment mode looking at a television or computer screen. Watch. Receive with meekness the implanted Word which is able to save your soul. Say it's the Word. Say this. The word is able to deliver me. What's going
to
determine if it will or not? If you receive it with meekness. If you receive it with meekness, you're going to do it. If you do it, you're not going to doubt. You're going to walk by faith. Your mind's going to get renewed.
Yes.
Amen.
And the Word will prevail.
Because
it always does.
Yes.
22. But be doers of the Word and not what? Hearers only. Deceiving who?
Yourself.
We got a lot of self-deceived Christians in the body of Christ. Because they've heard what the Word says they should do, but they don't do it. They don't do it. They keep choosing to do their own thing. Now, we're not talking about, I got to find everything the Bible says, start doing it by tomorrow. No, we're just saying you begin to learn what the Bible teaches you as a believer to walk out, and you receive it with humility. You say, I'm going to start doing that. The Bible tells me to forgive everybody. Guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to forgive. Yeah, but I don't feel like it, that you're not walking by feelings. Quit living by your five physical senses. Because as you keep walking by your five physical senses in those areas, guess what you're going to walk by when it comes to battles in your body physically with sickness and disease? Your five physical senses.
Right.
You're not going to walk by faith. You're going to have doubts.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You're going to know what the Word says, but you're going to be a double-minded man.
Yeah.
Oh, this is what James is trying to teach us.
Yes,
be doers of the Word and not what?
Hearers
only. Deceiving who? Ourselves, verse 25, but he who looks into the perfect law of liberty, the Word of God, and continues in it and is not a forgetful of hearer, but what?
A doer
of the work. This one will be.
Yes.
This one will be what? They will be blessed. They will be blessed in what they do. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Write these notes down real quick. I got to quit. Write this down. Mental assent. What is mental assent of the Bible? You know it in your head, but you're not living out what the basic Scriptures teach. You just keep hearing the Word, but you're not doing anything to change your lifestyle to apply what the Bible teaches. Mental assent admires, admits, but does not act. That is a powerful statement. Mental assent admires and admits, but it does not act. Mental assent could admire the Bible. Mental assent could admit to it being true, but it does not act. Mental assent is not doing what the Bible says. You just have knowledge of it in your head. And therefore, you're double-minded and you're going to be unstable on your ways, and the word will not prevail through your life. Because now, when you have to speak to a mountain, Mark 11, when you have to speak to some form of thing that comes against you and say what the word of God says, you'll speak it, but you know it's going to come? Doubt. Because you're not living the Bible out. Are you getting this tonight?
Yes.
Revelation knowledge, as I've already given you, comes to us how again? Through the recreated human spirit, by acting on the word and living in it. One more verse and I'll show you this. Go to James chapter 2. Just turn over one chapter. James chapter 2, verse 26. For as the body without the spirit is dead, lifeless, powerless, ineffective. I just defined it for you, the word dead. For the body without the spirit is what? Dead, lifeless, powerless, ineffective. Spirit leaves a body, that body's what? It's lifeless. It's lifeless, it's powerless, it's ineffective. It has no power in it. It's ineffective, can't do anything. Right? The minute a spirit leaves a body, it's worthless. Guess what? So faith without works, corresponding actions is what? Dead also. Now let me explain this. Because it's not just saying, if I believe that I'm healed, I'm going to act like it. True. It's actually more so saying that if you start walking by faith, what's faith? I'm going to find out what the Bible says I'm supposed to be living by according to the Scriptures, New Testament, and I'm going to do it. And then the more I start doing the Word, guess what? I'm becoming one with the Word. Because now I'm living out the Bible. The more you do what the Bible... Listen, isn't it simple to understand? Creatures of habit. If you practice something long enough, guess what? You get good at it.
That's right. Yep.
And if you practice it long enough and get good at it, you start believing in yourself. Right. In the natural. You start believing you can do what it is you've been practicing. You know what? That was God-given by God. You know why? Because the same thing is true of the Bible. When you start doing what the Bible says, you start becoming one with the Word. You start believing in the Word. Everything the Word says. Your mind is not fully renewed. Thank you, E.W. Kenyon. Your mind is not fully renewed by just mental assent of the Word, knowledge only. Your mind is renewed as you start doing the Word. Until you become one with doing the Word, your mind is not fully renewed. Simple truth. Because if my mind is already renewed to the Word, would I not be doing that? Why would I not be doing that? If my mind is renewed to that, why? How could I say my mind's renewed to that, but I'm not doing it? Then you're not truly renewed to it.
Yeah. Right.
Renewed. I'm going to do this a new way. So I renew my mind to the Bible. I start doing it. Now as I start doing it, my mind is renewed. Guess what goes? Doubt. Guess what goes? Double-mindedness. In all aspects of the Scriptures. This is good stuff, man. Are you still here? So what is this primary work? So you've been talking about this doing of the Bible, Pastor. What is this primary thing that we need to be doing with the Bible all about? I'm going to tell you Sunday night.
We pray that you are blessed by the message Pastor Baker shared with you today. For more spiritual resources that can help you in your walk with God, or to invite Pastor Baker as a guest speaker, just go to our website at cffchurch.com. You will find additional teachings by video, audio, and printed resources that will be a blessing to you. May God's very best be yours.